bad if BDD lives up to his potential.
Yeah, and there's a lot of pressure on him. And like I said, a lot of potential there for an upset. You never know. Could be, you know, first game, 17 years old. Good joke.
And your first game, first ban, you take that ban on the set.
Not surprising whatsoever that Kong do ban that one away. It's just his staple champion.
And look, we're putting a lot on a 17-year-old, untested and competitive player. Yes, scrimmed with the team in the last year. He actually moved into the house in February of 2015 and has been part of the squad since then, been in and out of the house based on his other responsibilities. The big question, though, for BDD is champion pool, because we know he can play assassins, but assassins don't always fit team comps. How will he look on wave clear? How will he translate to top play? BDD is next to all the other hype rookies. In my experience following the Korean scene, the track record of hype rookies goes, Dade was the first one, who really struggled at the start of his career, but obviously built a legend for himself eventually on new teams. After Dade was Faker, after Faker was Marin. Faker exploded out the gates. He was a superstar from game one. The other two took their time. What's the story going to be for BDD? He's against Kongdu Monster. It's a very winnable set for BDD. But it's one thing to be the guy who makes the great YouTube highlights, 10 minutes of amazing BDD outplays in solo queue. It's another thing to actually take a competitive game by the scruff of the neck and carry it. And that's what CJ expects with his potential.
Yeah, and I mean, for his sake, and with all the hype surrounding him, I really hope that he can do it. But we can see taking away the LeBlanc as well from him, so really just trying to deny him those assassins that he's so prominent on. Lista Gangplank again banned away by CJ, so still seeing bans for that. Kog'Maw was the last ban. Corki made it through. We saw this ban in both games between Jhin Air and Spenu, so it actually makes it through, and it is the first pick here for Kongdu Monster. But this could just be a Nidalee coming in for Bubbling.
So Bubbling does keep a spot. It's worth knowing that Daydream is available to play. Very experienced mid laner who previously played on CJ Enter's Blaze, but isn't playing this game. Of course, he hasn't played competitive play since he left Keed in April of 2015. So
it's been a little while.
So give him some time. He only joined the squad, I believe, a couple of weeks ago. So they're going to stick with Bubbling, who had a good series against Kongdu Monster. But of course, there's always that caveat when you have performances against one of those bottom place teams. He needs to show some consistency on champions outside of maybe Lee Sin in 2015.
Yeah.
And this year, look, fits and spurts on multiple different champions, but never been convincing. There's not going to be any Bubbling bans just yet.
Yeah, not quite. Hover on the Lulu here. It's been sitting for quite some time, so he might be
really
picked up. BDD's first game. Let's put him on one of the most consistent champions that you could possibly be on. It's Lulu, where it's almost impossible to lose lane.
But I know some people are going to be disappointed if it is Lulu mid, and honestly, it almost has to be. Fiora is already locked in.
Unless you would have put him, like, put it on Mad Life and support Lulu.
Well, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
It's not Lust Boy. Wrong CJ support. Not going to be a support Lulu. So it's going to be mid lane Lulu, which again goes against type. We conceptualize BDD as an aggressive assassin player. In an awkward spot, you're against Corki, LeBlanc, and Zed banned. There aren't really the assassins in the meta that really fit that spot against Corki. So he went for the safe choice in Lulu. Now, with Cassiopeia being mulled over, maybe they're looking to really target BDD and go for something punishing in lane, but
okay,
not so far.
So we're actually going to have the Nidalee locked in for Crush, and it's going to be Tahm Kench. Is this a support Tahm Kench or is this a top lane Tahm Kench?
Well, this is 6.4 where Tahm Kench hit another suite of nerfs. It felt like no one was playing Tahm Kench on 6.3, but now the Tongue Lash has that
its width,
narrower
its
width
in 10
general.
Units or something.
He's received his nerfs, so surprising to see him picked. Usually it's now, I feel like you only pick Tahm Kench now if you really need to deny an assassin. If the enemy picks Zed, absolutely Tahm Kench still makes sense. There's still the outside chance to top lane Tahm Kench, but with Nautilus still available and it being a cornerstone of Hippo's champion pool, I'd be surprised if it was Tahm Kench top.
Would certainly be interesting. And we can see the long hover over this Alistar. It's going to be locked in as well as at least four Bubbling. So Mad Life, you know, he's been playing a lot of Alistar, not as much as Gorilla, but a pretty good amount of it, and can perform on that champion. So not surprising. I'm surprised actually that it made it this far into the draft that he got picked up. So they do lock that one in. So just need to see what their AD carry is going to be on their last round. Kongdu going for their last round right now.
They're really hiding AD carry for Kramer. So with Kalista off the board, you have to think it's something for Wave Clear, because with the first picks, you knew exactly the game time, the game plan CJ had. Outscale, Fiora enters a team fight, Wild Growth kills everyone. How many times have we seen Smeb and Kuro show up on that duo and win games for the Rocks Tigers? They just need consistent wave clear in other lanes, and then they're looking to Untara to carry. So BDD's debut, it's all about Untara. And with his double MVP performance against Kongfu Monster last time, I guess I'm not surprised. As speaking of consistency, it's time for more Varus mid.
Yeah, so just going for the Varus mid. Looks like that will be a top lane Tahm Kench then. Maybe carry Corki. So interesting draft coming in from Kongfu Monster. A lot of poke damage here between the javelins. You know, you have your piercing arrow as well as Corki just constantly throwing rockets in your face. So good amount of poke damage. You know, if you land that binding from Googurt, you could really just have the team collapse onto somebody, slow them with the Tongue Lash, and just jump on them with Nidalee. So a good amount of follow-up. The question is just how this interaction with Tahm Kench is going to go against Untara's Fiora in the top lane, at least for me.
It's also very risky to go for Ezreal in this situation. You look down CJ's lineup, Lulu going to just wave clear in mid. Varus with at level 9 will actually be able to outpush Lulu in terms of speed.
We're going to go for it.
And then Untara needs time to get strong, get those two items on Fiora. Opting into a power trough in bot lane, we talked about a lot. You know, opting into the tier, not going to have lane control against Corki Morgana for sure. It's on bubbling, I think, to create enough pressure in the early game to get CJ to that spot where Fiora will be able to really get into the team fighting phase. Because you can see what will happen. Fiora will get into the back line, Wild Growth will come on. It's a Fiora-focused comp, but that's maybe why the Tahm Kench is the lock-in, because Fiora gets into the back, you just eat that Varus, you just eat that Corki.
Yeah.
The other one gets the Black Shield, and potentially you can maneuver a fight. But I think, to me, it's the jungle matchup. Can Crush emulate Crash and actually be an aggressive counter jungler, because the lanes from CJ, on the whole, are pretty weak.
Yeah, really just gonna be reliant on enabling Untara. Just scale out of control and carry the game. Meanwhile, you just get that smattering of consistent damage from the sidelines by Kramer. If he can position anywhere like Pilot does, they could very, very well take away this game.
CJ gets the time to scale. They certainly have a fearsome late game comp, but it's on Kongfu Monster to make those assertive early moves and punish them. They did that in game two. Remember, they won a game of that series against CJ Entus. Can they do it again, though? Can they recreate?
Yeah, well, that is the big question. One way to find out is when we get onto the Rift. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Champions. We are on to the map for the first game, Kongfu Monster versus CJ Entus. BDD, his first performance in Champions Korea.
What can he show on mid lane Lulu? The last hyped mid laner that we saw on a utility champ. I guess it's unfair to call Gangplank a utility champ, but Scout was the last really hyped mid laner. We saw him debut for SKT in the Kesper Cup and get run over on Gangplank. Now it's on BDD, who, let's be fair, he has a lot more hype than Scout did. This guy has really looked to carry CJ to a new generation with this new lineup. A lot about this lineup is supposed to run through BDD. This is the superstar of their lineup. Will he be that today, or will he take time? That's the question we don't know the answer to, but it's exciting to see him finally eligible to play, because the last 2 months have been a waiting game for CJ Entus for this day.
Yeah, this is, I mean, albeit Lulu, not the most exciting champion to see him on, but it is good that they are putting him on something that's not an assassin, so that if they do win this game, they at least have a demonstration of, okay, you know what, BDD is not a one-trick, he's not a Westor, he can play more than just assassins. So I can respect the decision, as disappointed as I am that we're not seeing some insane Zed play.
CJ, actually calling the lane swap.
Yep.
He's going to get the advantage here, they're going to pick up both of the small golems.
Oh, yep.
Sentinels, I believe, blue sentinels.
It does take those away, and they will be able to slide right back into the lane, so pretty good start here. Uber walking really far forward. Doesn't have to respect the combo from the Alistar quite just yet. A little ways before that level 2 mark comes in.
Usually you'd have to go a more defensive route, but because they knew that Guga had skilled Cool at level 1, they could walk pretty aggressively. Yeah. Madlife was happy to tank up damage, so they're going to definitely hit level 2 first.
Yep, goes in, gets the combo, knocks up Sol. Heal comes out automatically, the exhaust down onto Kramer. Sol, the flash forward by Madlife again, and Kramer taking first blood at 2.5 minutes in.
Kongdu Monster were just far too far up in their 2v2. They knew that CJ took extra time to make it to lane, so they should have expected there to be extra experience, but they didn't respect that the level 2 would be popped so early and get supremely punished, giving up both summoner spells and exhaust on Morgana so early in the game. It's going to be a rough laning phase, and this is against a 2v2 lane. They should win quite confidently.
Yeah, that is a fantastic start for Kramer.
You know what that means? It means a 3-minute tier.
It does mean a 3-minute tier.
Oh boy.
Pretty great start for him. Crush coming in, finding that his little blue sentinels are gone. We'll be able to finish off this blue buff, however. And then it looks like he's going to go for some invasive play against Bubbling, who is significantly healthier. Now he's going for the Skull Crab. So we'll be sticking to the river. But we'll see if he's going to be able to do those invasive plays on this Nidalee.
So the issue for Crush in this situation is that Varus only really gets lane control over Lulu around level 7 to level 9. In the early levels, the cooldown on the piercing arrow is so long, and these auto attacks are slightly less strong than the help picks, just general auto attacks from Lulu, that you can't clear waves, you can't match Lulu's wave clear until later in the game. So early on, probably going to have to stay out of that topside jungle, but later on, absolutely.
Kramer thinks that binding will get hit with a bit of damage, but here comes Madlife around the side.
No summoners are down on Corki.
There's going to be that black shield, however, gets thrown down onto Sol. Madlife just goes for the headbutt anyway, but it's not going to do anything.
That probably felt different in the head to Madlife. He's like, I've got... Oh, wait.
Crap.
No kill potential onto Corki once he had Valkyrie and the black shield.
He was in a decent spot to knock Guger up in, like, forward the lane into the brush, so a little questionable that he still decided to go for Sol. But I guess he just got locked onto that target and stuck with it, so nothing going to come of that gank. Still CJ in a pretty advantageous spot after getting that first blood so early. And yeah, being able to have that 3-minute tier for Kramer, he is going to stack that Man Immune so fast.
We talked a bit about, you know, being disappointed to not see the Zed. You know, was banned this game, but you know, we were looking for something along that time. We wanted to see an assassin. The thing about Lulu is that, let's think of another player who we're always hypercritical of his champion, but we think about Faker, right?
Yep.
This is a guy who, okay, we love him on aggressive champions. It's still a treat to watch Faker play Lulu because he's so damn aggressive on Lulu. How often does he take Ignite when we're like, wait, where's the teleport? Where's the cleanse? No, he only takes the Ignite. He does have cleanse, but you think about the Varus. When Varus with Flashdown is a juicy target to gank, and you've got Alistar on your team, you've got Elise. There are many different members from CJ Enders who can rotate through mid and punish the immobile Varus mid. So there is still kill pressure. In fact, speaking of kill pressure.
Yeah. Draws out the heal from Edge. Good on BDD to already knock down that summoner's spell. Of course, Flash still available for him. So still in a relatively safe spot in that lane. But not having that heal down could make him much more susceptible to a gank.
Especially by
Bubbling, who is now invading on Crush here.
Good timing. They know Edge is back. So free to invade, no potential pressure, even Madlife coming for the assist as well.
Yeah, really good roam down by him. Just in case a fight did break out, he would be there to back up his team. See Morgana roaming around, just trying to spot out Bubbling, get his pathing, and know where he's going to exit. He could go for a lane gank, but it looks like he's just going to go for the Krugs.
Honestly, it's good for Madlife to keep creating that pressure, because eventually, with Kramer and the big CS advantage he had, maybe Madlife will get that roam around behind the Varus and really open up the turret dives that are possible with Headbutt Pulverize, with the wild growth from BDD. So there is kind of an art. You know, we've seen so much Lulu mid for, it feels like forever now. It must have been about 18 months of Lulu mid, Lulu mid, Lulu mid. You still know the difference between Lulu played aggressively, played assertively, and Lulu that's just sticking behind. Of course, Sky played a lot of Lulu, but that was a very passive Lulu that was just about scaling up and ulting people in teamfights.
Yep.
There's optimism that BDD can show the aggressive side that we look to Faker and know that he can pull out.
Yeah, and so far, I mean, just pushing up on the Edge like that, like he just did just a few minutes ago, showing that he does seem to lean towards that more aggressive Faker-esque Lulu playstyle. So good showing from him so far, even in CS. even though he, you know, denied him and pushed him back to the base. So still going to be even there. Bubbling trying to clear out that pink ward, not going to be able to get at his edge. Those piercing arrows do hurt a little bit when you don't have really any defensive stats. Or very
few. Double pinks to that side is up. Grand challenge.
Yep. Throw him down on Hippo. Takes him down quite low. Gray health not going to get popped though. Edge in a really bad spot. The exhaust. The headbutt back. He's going to go down. Bubbling taking the kill. And that's a second on the board for CJ Entis.
We talked about people rotating through mid. That's what happens when you see Varus. So immobile. So easy to gank. We didn't see how that gank started, but came off. Madlife's taking turret aggro.
Yeah, only taking a few shots. Oh, flashes it, bumps, crush back, and they take him down. Bubbling, finding his second kill. Fantastic play by Madlife right there, creating another opportunity for a kill.
I need to see a replay. I think that was a headbutt flash. I didn't even know that interaction existed. Of course, Lee Sin kick flash.
The wind up, yeah.
Has always been there. We'll have to see the replay because
it looked
Bubbling crazy.
Bubbling going around the map,
space.
Draws out the flash from Hippo. He tries to avoid that cocoon. Bubbling adding pressure all over the map right now.
Varus, there's no way for him to react, and CJ capitalizing on pressure, first on the top side when Bubbling forced the edge recall, and then Bubbling invading to punish Crush as well. Second time tonight we've seen a Nidalee actually lose out in the early pressure game to the opposing jungler.
Yeah, Crush just not able to step up to the plate. Bubbling just doing a fantastic job on this Lee's, creating pressure all over the map. Hongdu are just struggling to find some ground in this game right now. You can see the package has been picked up by Seoul. Might be looking to make some sort of play onto Kramer, but it's really contingent on landing a binding from Uber. With a champion as evasive as Ezreal is, good luck doing that.
It's so crazy how a 2v2 lane that was landslide in the advantage of Corki Morgana was decided by level 1. CJ made the aggressive move, invading to stop any potential lane swap, picking up the extra experience, and then just not hesitating whatsoever on pulling the trigger. The two most experienced members of this lineup, Kramer and Madlife, really coming through and turning on the head what should have been a one-sided matchup for Corki Mor.
Yeah. There's Crush trying to, you know, finally apply some pressure. Fades in for that red buff. So, after Bubbling has taken his, so they will just trade those buffs. Now he's going for the Raptors here, but Bubbling is going to come around the sidelines. He has to fear this Elise.
Good timing from Crush once again. Lulu was the base. See some trading into bot lane.
Yep, does not get to repose the Devourer as desired. Still gets eaten up. Hippo taking a bit of damage. That's going to be the grand challenge. Thrown down. Hippo quite low. Still has all that gray health. Untara is just going to go ahead back off. Decided to go for the minions. Now Bubbling getting engaged on here. It's a piercing arrow, but the spooky ghosts come out and they will scare them away. BDD doing well to help pressure back. This jungler is in a bad spot. Untara could get devoured again here. Hippo's not going to be able to get range for it. So they're going to trade back and forth pretty consistently and pretty evenly in that bot side.
It's a lot of mind games though, you know, waiting for that cooldown. If you riposte the devour, you win the trade. If you don't, you get punished. So it's really exciting to watch that. The second time the grand challenge was popped, it looked like if all vitals were hit, there'd be a kill. But the issue was, there was such a big minion wave. Oh, boy,
here
Hippo.
We go. Yeah, Untara going back in. Pops a great health. He can very easily dive this one. Takes him down, and that's the Untara that we've been expecting from this game. Gets his first solo kill in that bot side of the map.
And that was just a mistake from Hippo. He was allowed to teleport back into lane with a freshly bought Tiamat and extra longswords, full health, and punish. I guess Hippo thought without the grand challenge available, there wouldn't be enough damage. But smart play from Untara, solo kill from Untara. That's actually been a consistent thing we've been able to say a couple of series in a row.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to look at BDD. He's the guy we're most interested in. But the development of Untara is a secondary storyline that should hearten CJ fans who first have got optimism around Kramer and his pentakills. Then it's Untara showing that he can carry on Fiora, Poppy, trying to add new champions to the champion pool. Now BDD as well. You worry that at some point these CJ fans are going to get just too excited because young talent across the board is doing impressive things for CJ Entis.
Yeah, and here comes Bubbling down to this bot lane. Hippo's going in aggressive. Will go for the Devourer. Gets it onto Untara. Bubbling's just waiting for him to get spat out. Crush is now in here. The dash away, the flash cocoon. Crush just gets caught right in the face by that one. They go forward onto him. Looks like he's going to go down. Untara takes that one. And now the grand challenge thrown down onto Hippo. Nothing that he can do. Let's get the Devourer onto Bubbling, but it's only going to go so far for him. Actually, he does finish him off. Good lord, the damage coming through from the Tahm Kench. Really surprising me. Untara not able to finish him off, and now maybe in a bad spot. Has to respect this damage output.
So twice in a row. Wow, Untara actually took AoE there.
Yeah, Hippo, he does have flash up in a little bit. Not going to be able to get it, though. Oh, that, yeah, the wave's there, so it will block the tongue lash.
So twice in a row, you've seen Untar step back because he sees that the minion wave has been fixed. The first time he popped Grand Challenge, I thought, okay, going to go for the all-in. Saw that with all the minion damage, he would have lost the trade. And that's why he also didn't re-enter that fight just there. Respecting minions is actually the potential for a 1-for-2 trade against Hippo, who's coming back on this Tahm Kench. We thought Tahm Kench was gone as a top laner, but still making him work.
Yeah. Quite surprised. I really underestimated the damage that he was going to deal to Bubbling there. That tongue lash just ripping through the remaining like 10% of his health. Some good stuff by Hippo. Slight reprieve for Kong Du Monster to give that kill over onto him. But CJ still sitting about 1.2 thousand gold ahead. Just 13 minutes into this game. So in a pretty advantageous spot.
You scale so well in team fights with
Bubbling on the run out. Crush laying down the damage. EZ coming around the sidelines. The binding is not going to connect, and that should just be the disengage from both sides.
Madlife was doing a lot of body blocking, so.
Yeah, good on him.
Knew his role.
Tar going in for the trade again onto Hippo. Gets devoured immediately. See how much damage it deals this time. Both down to about half HP. Grand Challenge not available. The great health is there for Hippo. He does pop the shield. Lands the tongue lash, but the riposte comes through. Untar goes back in. There's the Grand Challenge, but he gets devoured immediately. This could go either way. Dashes through. Can he get it? The heal from Crush will keep Hippo alive, and that is going to be Untar going down.
Really clutch flash heal. We do see the Ezreal coming, but so far away. Surely not.
No. Would have hit if he didn't move, but even then, I don't think it would have killed Hippo. But fantastic arrival by Crush to keep his top laner alive. Find that kill. Bubbling comes around the side, gets that flash out from Edge, though, so they can still punish this mid lane repeatedly.
You can see CJ know how to play around this mid lane Varus. Every 3 or 4 minutes, the moment you're given a reprieve up top, Madlife makes a visit mid. Bubbling makes a visit mid. No summon of Varus basically clears waves from behind his turret, but can never actually push a minion wave into the enemy turret because he has to sit so far back, can't get in range of auto attacks. So really punishing this Varus pick that, once again, Kong Du Monster are really trying to make work.
Yeah. That's working pretty well so far.
It's going okay, but the issue is in a late game team fight, no flash, Lulu, speeds up the Fiora and then Wild Growths, and then Varus just dies.
Yeah, that's very true.
I don't like Varus when Lulu, Fiora already locked in because the teamfight conceptualization, I just don't see a fight where Varus makes the difference when that combination had already been locked in first rotation by CJ.
Yep. Despite that early discrepancy created, you know, for the bot lane of Kongdu, they're still maintaining CS pretty evenly here, 141 to 141. So Sol still CSing quite nicely, has that Trinity Force completed. So he does have a good amount of his damage from his kit available to him. Needs those boots to really find that spike.
Well, a lot about this matchup reminds me of Game 2 of Kongdu Monster versus CJ Entes, which is the one that Kongdu won. Remember, they ran a poke comp, and CJ had no initiation. If I remember correctly, CJ was running a comp of Gangplank, Rek'Sai, Zilean, Cog'Maw, Braum, where it was, all right, put the speed buff on Rek'Sai and maybe a flash on Burrow, but like no initiation, run around the map, the siege comp worked. The issue here is that they have a very strong siege comp. Nidalee, Varus, Corki walk up to the enemy turret. Tahm Kench can eat one of them if they're initiated on. Absolutely, on paper, very strong. But the first two picks are Lulu and Fiora. You know that if you ever miss your timing window, if you don't have a big gold lead in the early game, Fiora's going to show up behind you, get Wild Growth, and that's all she wrote. So Kongdu can't afford to be even. They need to be taking structures. They need to be getting ahead before Fiora really becomes super scary. And the fact that they're 700 gold down at 16 minutes bodes poorly for Kongdu.
That is very true. Good points. Especially since Ezreal was given such an early opportunity to start his scaling as well, which means he's just going to become a nuisance that much faster in this game. I'd like to see how stacks his tiers, but it cannot. That's going to be the engage. They knock Guger in underneath the tower. Here comes Untar from the backside.
I don't think
there's any getting out here from either of these players. So the Grand Challenge has been issued. He will go ahead and finish it. He goes down. BDD actually shows up and finds the kill for himself. Guger does manage to walk out with his life, however, after black shielding himself.
It's a big investment. But they use the teleport for just a kill. There's no other objective to take. Maybe they'll try and take a Rift Herald, but I don't know if that was really necessary. just padding your stats with a kill doesn't mean much in the grand scheme of things. Dragon's up, but no way for Kongdu to actually punish them. So it ends up being just a kill for advantageous minion control, but maybe even a turret. If he gets this turret, it's actually overall leaked Kongdu monster.
Yeah, and he will get this tower. The minion's able to finish it off, so just recall here. So very nice pickup coming in for Kongdu off the back side of that kill on their AD carry in the top side of the map. If they'd gotten the double kill, would have been a bit closer, but still very solid for Kongdu.
The double kill would have meant turret pressure, would have meant turret, and maybe also turning that into the Rift Herald, but end result is much more even. First kill of BDD's career. You'll remember that one. Following the same school of thought as a lot of the mid lane Lulu players, they've gone a lot less utility focused and been going for Lich Bane second.
Yeah, Moon Soul has the package available, so he will go ahead and get himself to safety.
At least he's going bloodthirsty with the Lulu build, right?
Yes. Yeah. Lich Bane Lulu.
It's been quite common. Faker loves it. We saw a couple of other mid lanes use it. It means you don't necessarily have that second round of shields or that second whimsy.
Ooh, Untara finds Crush. He's going to get slowed out by the spooky ghost. Jumps over the wall. Untara says, I have a dash. I can do that too. But Edge is there for the pickup. Takes his jungler into his welcoming arms and says, you're safe.
That's Tom Kench. He's the one that has the welcoming arms on the side.
He's got a welcoming mouth.
Let's not play with that one too much.
That's going to be the Rift Herald traded for the first dragon. Oh! No. Oh! God, he almost got it. That made me jump. Ooh, so close, but Crush is able to walk away.
He smited that really late, actually. Yeah. Maybe he was trying to hold on to it and then just kind of like panic smited in the air. He's like, I hope it hit. Yeah, I got the Baron. Got it, guys. Nailed it.
Well, it certainly made my heart stop for a second. I thought Kramer actually did it. But yeah, again, a really good trade for Kongdu taking that dragon as opposed to the Rift Herald.
They're not done, though. I like how Kongdu keeps pushing.
Yeah.
It's only Fiora. Got no wave pill. Lulu hasn't responded.
Yeah,
Alistar obviously doesn't really provide very much, so keep pushing.
Yeah, why not? They do lose the top tier 1 tower, but if they get a tier 2 bot, that's perfectly worth it. It looks like they will be able to take this one. Knock up on the soul, though. No grand challenge coming through quite just yet. BDD takes a lot of damage. Crush goes forward. The wild goes onto himself. Everybody taking a hell of a lot of damage. Now Madlife getting consumed by Hippo. Ultimate's been used. Flash not available for him. He goes down. The piercing arrow snipes him out. And Kongdu will walk away with a kill.
Lulu had to be so conservative with how he passed to top. We saw BDD have to walk all the way around. It's why he was late. Madlife tried to re-engage. This wasn't Kramer. Kramer wasn't there. He was still shopping. He was still finishing off his build. He will have more mana very quickly.
Yep.
But it's only a single kill and, crucially, not an inner turret. So, once again, only the minimum for Kongdu Monster.
Yeah, really close to that inner turret, though. They almost made it very advantageous for them on that push. But still good, seemingly good decision-making by Kongdu. They do get that kill, so pretty solid by them. And Kramer still just farming up in this bot lane. The Mormana completed at 20 minutes.
Well, that's what happens when you get a 3 minutes here.
Yeah, really, really fast. Of course, it has been buffed. Again, that passive mana generation that it does give.
Again, that's pretty minimal. If you get it fast, you're going to have it transform fast. Honestly, 20 minutes is very close to the old transformation times of years ago when we saw 18-minute transformation. So 3 is certainly above average. We'll see when we see the transformation from Edge, although he hasn't invested into the Mana Moon just yet.
I miss the days of...
Do you, though?
I miss the days of Jace when his transformations gave you stacks.
Yes, Nidalee as well.
Yeah. He's just so stupid strong.
Well, those days, thankfully, firmly behind us at this point.
Yeah. I'd say no more.
But the scaling time's over for CJ Entis. They have the Muramana completed, BDD didn't go for Rod of Ages, so there's immediate power now. We're half an item away from two-item CJ, and the Siege comp hasn't hit their timings at all. Only one turret, even in turrets, so this is the worry now, that CJ will start to power ahead, but such a nice move from Kongdu. Once again, rotating around Fiora, one thing she doesn't provide is wave clear.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the TM is there to sort of do that in the AoE wave clear, but not going to be able to find it. Soul, though, getting found out in the bot lane. They headbutt him back. Grand Challenge comes down. There's no saving this man's life. He goes down. Untara finds that kill. Let's get the flash out from Hippo as he is teleported into the carnage. Guger going to get popped as well. A double kill for Untara so far. Hippo pops the black shield. Black shield, the gray health. will get a consume off, but it does not matter. He goes down. And now Edge caught with the cocoon. He's going to fall as well. That's a kill over to Bubbling. I believe his third of the game. Crush arriving just a little bit too late to stop anybody. Now it's 10-3. CJ Entis just starting to run away with this game.
I just love how CJ is so smart. They see two members, including the jungler, committed to taking down that top turret. And they call on Tara, say, make a teleport play. We can make it work. Really nice aggressive flash from MadLife. They pick up the first kill. MadLife tanks the turret aggro with that ultimate. And that's all she wrote.
Yeah, and MadLife is playing really well this game. His flanks have been on point. His, like,
just watch the flash. A flash into instant headbutt. No time to flash even for Soul, let alone the cast animation of Valkyrie. One person goes down. And then as the teleport completes for Hippo, he's like, oh crap. I'm in the middle of all of this. First it was MadLife. Then it was Untara tanking this turret with the Wild Growth. Really excellent spot-on turret tanking.
Yep.
Edge in no man's land, and CJ, four kills, a turret, everything going right for CJ Entis.
Yep, pretty fantastic trade for them. So 40,000.3 gold now.
Nope, not 40,000.3 gold.
40,300.
Okay. All right, acceptable.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, being dyslexic with how I...
That's fair.
Based by senses. It's
you
all
got,
right.
You got this, mate. You got it.
40,500 to 37,800. So pretty substantial lead coming in from them, where before it was just about a couple hundred gold separating these teams. So really big power play off of that last fight in that flank.
And again, Siege Comp. Yep. Losing turrets. Only even still. Now they're finally getting this five-man Siege Comp going. But this is after all the power spikes have been hit for CJ. So they get that lane ward. If they get the flank, if Fiora gets a Wild Growth next to a couple of people from Kongnu Monster, expect fireworks.
Yeah. Okay, we're coming around the side. Has to respect that he could just get grabbed up by Tom Kencher, so he's going to back off a little bit. But CJ, with this good flank pressure from MadLife, are going to stave off this assault on their mid lane tower.
No teleport on Untara, so engaging is quite difficult. It's actually a pretty good window for Kongnu to try and group. They just need to be so smart around their flanks. We already saw Spenu struggle to do that in the last series, so... Fiora's going to leave. This is actually a window for Kong. This is CJ saying we can't defend this turret.
Yep.
There's no teleport, so no way to group spy with CJ.
Yeah. It's going to be the Triforce proc damage coming in from Corki. Makes quick work of those towers, so they are able to take that one down. So 3-2.
I like that with the new range indicators, it looks like geometry problems happening. I'm like, oh, the square root. Oh, sorry, not the right one. The acute angles everywhere. Oh, geometry. I gotta say, I was pretty good at algebra, geometry, not math.
I was never good at math.
That's why I can't play Velkos.
I was never good at math, that's why I can't say what the gold lead is.
That's fair. We shouldn't cast Hearthstone together then. Yeah, it's lethal every time.
That would be very bad. But that will be the first dragon of the game for CJ, second overall. So good pickup for them. It's gonna deny that tower taking buff from the second dragon away from Kongdu for at least another 6 minutes. So solid play by them. Good control of the map by CJ right now.
Just wait for the teleport to come up from Untara, then look for lane wards, look for flank wards, because Kongdu have to group as 4 and 5. That's what the comp is designed to do.
Yep.
And then MadLife, always smart about putting down those aggressive wards. If the right one's there, home guard's riding in, that's when CJ will really be able to punch. Otherwise, you know, when the teleports are down, if they make a misfire on that teleport, they really don't have too much of an answer to Kongdu's siege comp.
Really have to respect Utara's damage now. Black Cleaver has been completed, as has his Merc Treads, something that we saw get buffed in this patch. Another change for 6.4. It's another 10% tenacity, quite nice.
For free as well.
Yeah.
No change in gold. No change in the magic resist, but honestly, one of the reasons we saw so many swiftness boots was 20% tenacity. You think about CC duration, the longest in the game is 2.5 seconds, so half a second, that's the most you're ever going to get. Oh, Bubble gets caught.
Yeah, he gets caught.
It's gonna be fine.
None of the skill shots landing, however, so it doesn't even
on the
get,
stationary opponent.
Yeah, he doesn't even get junked out.
But 10% extra tenacity, suddenly with that mastery, of course, all junglers are taking 50% tenacity and slow resist in the right-hand tree. When you add it with, when you multiply it in with the Merc Treads, it's a decent amount of tenacity. So the boots are definitely worth a look, whereas before Swiftness Boots, in so many different ways, outclassed the Merc Treads.
So CJ just trying to manage these waves and then crashing back towards the base of Kongdu. Kramer moving that one up in the top side of the map. Good return out the binding, not able to land it on the bubbling. So that there'd be too much follow-up anyway.
So this game really goes downhill for Kongdu if they lose their outer mid lane turret. That's when you get the aggressive lane ward in mid. That's when Untara shows up behind your team. That's when you die. But because it's the consistent wave clear from Varus, they've never managed to get that big pick onto Varus and take that outer turret. So for now, the map is actually narrow enough that there really isn't a flank ward that can super punish Kongdu, so they can just keep up what they're doing. And it's going to be on CJ to actually make something happen without the most tools to actually make that initiation.
BDD and Edge just going back and forth.
Clearing waves.
Just clearing waves with skill shots over and over again. Crush trying to acquire a bit of vision control around that Baron pit. Don't think we're going to see that come into contention until after a pretty major team fight.
And this game's at a standstill. They can't take this out of turret because Varus has so much wave clear from a million miles away.
It's going to be the chain thrown down onto Bubbling. Has to go up with the Repel. Really nowhere to go. Flashes away, though. We'll take him to safety. The Piercing Arrow does connect, but it's not enough to finish him off. Madlife gets bound up. Meanwhile, in the bot lane, Hippo and Untara are going to be duking it out. Madlife will get away with his life, and Untara has to flash over the wall.
The
Tongue Lash lands for the stun. He gets devoured. He's going to go down. Hippo with the solo kill onto Untara.
And we actually see the demonstration of why I said the game was a standstill. Hippo invested in the QSS, could just QSS the Grand Challenge. Suddenly, no kill pressure for Untara, can't win that split push battle. The mid lane turret being up, so they can't actually get the flank. Kongdu Monster playing really smart around their power spikes right now. They're going to stop pushing.
Yes, they are. Soul gets caught on the sidelines with a cocoon. We'll be able to Valkyrie to safety. Kramer just trying to clear out these waves as fast as he possibly can to stave off this Tower Siege from Kongdu Monster, but yeah, fantastic by Hippo picking up that QSS. Really smart itemization to just deny Untara any trade ability.
It's the same as Zed's Deathmark.
Yep.
The moment you see ult popped and you're a tank, you're like, oh crap, 40% true damage, whatever it is. Negating that, suddenly you are tanky enough on this time, Kench. They can return to this four-man split push. There's only one ward that you could teleport into, that's in the right side brush of mid lane, but Tara just respawned, doesn't have a chance to get there. CJ are in a bind, because they cannot win the split push, and they haven't got the lane wards. So unless Kongdu Monster start pushing into inhibitor turrets, for now, there just really isn't a way for CJ to engage.
Yeah, really rough spot for these guys. That's going to be Kongdu slipping into a very slight gold lead.
The big issue is how does Kongdu grow that lead? Because the moment they push into inhibitor turrets, could be punished from a multitude of different angles with the teleport. The moment they group at Baron, could be punished with a much more shallow ward than is necessarily available to CJ. So it's very much a standstill right now. And when you're all about Siege versus a team that does have the team fighting advantage, you just feel that the inexperience of Kongdu will kind of come to a crescendo all at the same moment, just like we saw from Spenu Sonic Boom in game one of last series.
Looks like right now, neither team able to figure out what to do. Edge gonna be taking a little bit of damage here. It's gonna be True Shot Barrage thrown out, takes it down to about half HP. Cougar did use the ultimate onto Bubbling in the jungle. A little bit of an odd decision. Let's go ahead and pop that ultimate where it looks like we could have a team fight coming up here.
And Madlife walk up. They need Madlife and Bubbling to get people away from this turret. They need to take it down. It's so hard to really explain to the viewers how important it is for CJ to open up the map and take this outer turret, because with that QSS, they just have no other pressure points if they can't take out that turret.
Dragon spawning in 15 seconds. Both of these teams would be very happy with taking that one away. You can see Hippo just taking up a hell of a lot of damage. He's taking down to about half HP, but with that great health, he will regenerate a good amount of that.
This Tom Kench will be K.
Yeah. He's fine. He hasn't even gotten the annoying items yet, like Zerat Portal.
It's only a matter of time. Spirit Visage also for a bit more healing.
So both teams just kind of tiptoeing around this dragon as Varus creates some pressure in that mid lane, shoving the waves towards that tier two. CJ does go ahead and start this one up. Both junglers have smite available. There could just be a smite war. Hippo trying to poke with that tongue lash. Madlife looking for an in. So low, that's gonna be CJ taking it away. They win the smite war. Madlife takes a hell of a lot of damage though, has to pop the ultimate. And that's likely going to be CJ Entis backing off, but they could lose a tier 2 tower for this.
Kongdu get the inside track. Ezreal comes to clear minions, not enough. They're going to lose this mid lane tower. It's only the inner one, but still, no No opportunity for CJ to punish. No flank teleport. They get a free objective. Good stuff for Kongdu. And now they can set up around Baron as well.
Yeah, and they're just stretching this gold lead. You ask, how do you grow it? It's like, well, you lose the dragon. Just go take the tower. Take away a bit of the jungle as well, so denying that red buff.
Narrowest of advantages, though.
Yeah. Still not out of the woods. Still in a rough spot. All of them grouping up in this rush, trying to look for a pick, not able to find it quite just yet, but Madlife is looking for the engage, only finds Hippo with that knockup. He takes a bit of damage, but Madlife, no ultimate's gonna have to back off of this. As he gets taken quite low as well. Kramer gonna juke out the javelin and the tongue lash. Piercing Hero not gonna connect, jumps out of the way, will keep himself alive for the time being. But can only do so much against this Tom Kenshi, who's just so very tanky.
This game is so even, a 6-kill lead and still behind in gold to Kongdu Monster. CJ, until they can get that flank, they really are at wit's end on how to actually push this game, how to actually push a lead. Untara cannot still out-duel Hippo in a side lane. And with this mid lane turret seemingly everlasting, they're kind of waiting for Kongdu to make a mistake, and Kongdu steadfastly have not.
Yeah, doing quite the opposite of Spenu, just playing to their advantages quite effectively.
Doing the opposite of Spenu is very recommended in Champions 2016.
Always do that.
What would Spenu do? All right, disregard that.
Pick Nautilus mid.
Well, look, I mean, Edge hasn't done much, but can wave clear, so that's been something. And they've just never been out-rotated to the extent where they've lost that mid lane turret.
Yeah.
That's what's keeping them so comfortably in the game. Think about this turret advantage. It's two turrets to none in the mid lane.
Yep. Three towers up for Kongdu, creating the pretty much entirety of that lead that they have at the moment.
And then you look at CJ. All right. One of these AD carries is overextending for turret damage. Let's punish them. So there's a Tahm Kench there, there's a Morgana there, and your initiation is Alistar,
yep.
Elise Cocoon. Very unreliable engage outside of the teleport plays that have been so well denied.
Yep. You can see again Kongdu doing very well to maintain vision control of this Baron pit.
So Kongdu's only problem is, you saw it around the Baron, they were smart in understanding, well, we'd like this dragon, but a comp doesn't really fight a dragon. So they were poking around, hoping for the steal, but they weren't committing. That was a situation where Spenu would hard commit for a second dragon and lose the game. Kongdu so far have been smart. It's when a pick happens, when Baron start. Let's see if this shot calling is as clean for Kongdu, because it's a game of inches for a poke comp when they group up around an objective.
Yep. Hippo just walking up here, willing to take all of this damage that's being thrown out by Kramer. That's going to be the Alistar combo used, but Madlife taking so much damage, has to pop his ultimate for the game to really happen. Here comes Untara and bubbling from the sidelines. The Varus getting consumed by Tahm Kench, trying to get him to safety. Now Hippo just taking up so much damage, has to pop the shield, flashes over the wall into the Raptor pit, might be alive. It's going to be Devour onto Untara, who should be able to finish him off with relative ease. The Wild Growth comes through as well. Hippo goes down, Crush jumping back in. Probably ill-advised, almost goes down. Untara is still on the chase. The javelin's not going to be able to find anybody. This is going to be Kongdu running for the hills. CJ still hurt, so they cannot take the Baron, but they might be able to open up the map and take this Tier 1 tower in the mid lane finally.
It sounds so crazy that a Tier 1 turret is the reward for a one team fight of 35 minutes, but it's desperately what CJ needs. You saw how messy that fight was.
Yeah.
Untara got into a decent position, but there was no ability to combo with BDD. BDD had to walk up past his chunked out Alistar. If Alistar was full health and Madlife could actually be disrupting in the middle of the fight, that was the fight CJ so desperately needed. But there was no ability to get everyone on the same page after Madlife was chunked out, so it's just a single kill, and crucially, no objective for CJ. The moment they get one objective, it's going to be two, three. It's going to be raining in gold, but till then, they still face this 1,000 gold disadvantage.
And now, right back to the Baron pit goes Kongdu Monster, just clearing out any vision that CJ tries to apply to it. And they're going to go ahead and start this one up. That's going to be the teleport coming in here from Hippo, answered by Untara. Baron's already down below half HP. Untara gets bound up, will be able to dash over the wall. It's going to be a smite war. He goes in, and it's going to be Kongdu confirming it. Crush jumping out of the backside of the pit. Untara cannot chase as he gets devoured by Hippo, finally dashes over the wall. Kramer is here as well. Looks like they will be able to take down the Nidalee. Meanwhile, Hippo caught by bubbling with that cocoon popped up in the air. He's going to go down, so two Baron buffs lost by Kongdu, but they still secure it and the gold.
Give up two kills. If they could have got away with just one, again, it would have been a one trade.
And now they're going to lose the tower.
But they're going to lose this turret. But will they lose a lot more? That's the question. It's going to be one turret.
Yeah.
It's five members. You have to respect that. CJ are looking for as many objectives as possible. And and you look at the remaining members, crucially, they don't have Hippo, so there's literally no front line for Konglu. You have to run. Elise is enough to force all three members of Konglu to walk back.
Yeah, so that's two towers taken by CJ off of that push, so losing the Baron, but now acquiring a gold lead for themselves. Kramer taking quite low, has to be careful. Bubbling really deep in the base here. Goes up with the Repel to deny that tower aggro. He will have to exit here with the rest of the team as they kite back.
Death timers are so long. Hippo's still dead for 15 seconds. They realize there's no front line. CJ tried to do the highway robbery. They tried to take all three mid lane turrets. They get close to it. They equalize, and they're now ahead in gold with those two turrets. Dragon spawns in two, but they need to shop.
Yeah, they have to go back, spend this gold that they just netted for themselves, heal up as well. But, you know, this could just be Konglu rushing for the dragon, which would secure their second, and it looks like that is going to be what's happening.
Interestingly, we see Bubbling to the top side. He did just use a smite on the Raptors, though, so no real Baron threat. It's going to be answering second dragon for Konglu monster. Second dragon, you know, with the burn effect now, any of these ranged auto attackers, and Konglu have four, do respectable damage to turrets, so now it's all about a pick. Will we see Untara in the back line, Wild Growth, GG, CJ enters, or Konglu getting a pick, walking up to turrets and just deleting them?
Question yet to be answered. Untara, though, back on the split push game. Neither of these top laners, of course, having their teleports as it was used during that Baron fight.
Oh boy, Warmog's armor for Hippo. That's turning the clock back. Don't see Warmog's very often.
Yeah, that is interesting.
Tanky boy.
Yeah, very, very tanky.
QSS, the Grand Challenge, no true damage, and he'll be fine. Soul.
Oh, Madlock goes in, gets the flash, does not get the pulverize, though, as Soul uses his flash to counteract that, but this will be a four-man push now, as Kramer joins his team in this top lane. Gets the turret down to about half HP, but can't get too much else done. Hippo on the roam over. Kramer takes that javelin to the face, has to back off. We'll get out with his life, however.
Doesn't have one guy's lifesteal for Blade of the Rune King, so he'll be fine.
Yeah, very slight amount.
10%.
He did not take Warlords. So far, Warlords is 0-2 in Champions.
I don't think you would take Warlords in Ezreal.
Yeah.
It's not the one you get it on.
Yeah.
All right, Konglu. Doing what they know, the 4-5 mana mid. Notice there is flank wards, but crucially, no teleport on Untara for about a minute and a half.
So, ways to go onto that one. Buff has already been taken, so they can't deny that one away from CJ, but good basic play and ward control in this jungle.
We got the Raptor buff as well, which gives him a bit more information.
Yeah, Kramer coming around the side here. Chunks out Guger, does not get hit by that javelin. Madlife looking for the end. They slow out Guger, who's taking so much damage. Still does not have the True Shot Barrage, that added cooldown.
Peel just used just to get a bit of movement speed there, actually.
Yeah. Just has to pop that one by Edge. Get his team to safety. So good chunk out by Kramer here on a Guger. Does not net them a kill, however.
Kramer on blue Ezreal. Back to that reality again, Achilleos. It's such a weird world where we have Lulu Ezreal and Ezreal being the ones to get the Whimsy target and not the Fiora. But
yeah.
Fiora's the all-in Whimsy, and Ezreal's the one that tries to skirt around. You see that at this point, four items and a QSS. Ezreal does a lot of damage, specifically to Morgana, who's still very, very squishy.
Yeah. So far, CJ not able to really find a way back into a decisive lead.
It's so hard.
Falling slightly behind by about 500, so it's a really close game. They're still down a tower, but now even in dragons as well.
But this is the room on the map that is needed for Madlife and Bubbling to get those wards we've been talking about. They need to get the Tracker's Knife wards, the Sidestone wards. They need a flank from Untara. He's got Flash up. He's got his Teleport up. Now, the next time Konglu Monster look to punish, look to group as four or five, that's where finally we might see the big engage that CJ have really been waiting for the best part of 20 minutes.
Yeah. Clearing out the vision here. Baron's not going to be spawning for a little bit more time.
That's a scary Alistar.
Yeah, very scary Alistar.
Back to the Boots of Mobility with the further nerfs to Swifties on patch 6.4. Now has 5 flat move speed less as well to compound the growing cost and other incidental nerfs received recently.
Yep, CJ just going back into this mid lane. It's a bit of damage on the edge, but that's easily healed up by Crush on this Nidalee. So far, just poking around each other, just trying to get enough damage that MadLife can reliably and safely engage on the enemy team to find more than just a single kill.
You're also talking about an Alistar engaging, which it's not clean, it's not what you want.
Yeah.
See, this Voyage is probably just for.
It's going up to the top lane. Yeah, it's anticipating this wave crash on the tier 2.
So many items piled on everyone. You know, 4 items in the mid lane. Looks like Lutari's going to go back and probably finish up Mercurial Scimitar, or at least be close to it. No?
Yep.
Just another shopping trip.
God, I want Hippo to finish this QSS.
This game could literally go forever. Achilleos, we've got 2 dragons answered on both sides. A 5th dragon win condition is kilometers away. I guess hours away is probably more appropriate.
It's a ways off.
The team with the map control finds it hard to take Baron because they don't have too much of a tank line. Obviously, Hippo can tank for days, but it's also a risk to group up. Connects to the Whimsy and all the mobility that Fiora has. So, how to push forward? The next Baron is probably going to be the true battleground this game because come to get another one. Should be lights out.
Bubbling, just spawning out Hippo. It does have, you know, both top laners have those teleports available, of course. So if somebody does start up this Baron, as we saw last time, both of those top laners are just going to pull the trigger on those teleports during their team. Kramer gets hit by a big one. It's not going to take too much damage. He's trying to clear out this wave as quickly as he can without using the True Shot Barrage. He wants that for the fight. Never mind.
Line skill shots everywhere.
Never mind, he's just going to use it. He's got a blue buff, so it'll come back up quickly.
Yeah, remember, does have the 1.5 second reduction on the Q, which was a big change in the AD carry rework. That's why at 80 seconds, it felt like his ult cooldown was about 20 seconds. Now it's probably up to about 45, 50, so more window of counterplay.
Kramer just jumping forward, trying to get as much chip damage on the Hippo as possible, but you got an Italy, you've got a Warmogs. And a Spirit Visage, he's just, it doesn't even matter. Any damage you put on him without the whole team piling on is just going to be negligible.
I remember the Kongu Monster versus CJ game when no one had initiation.
Yep. Oh my god, Bubbling taking a lot of damage. They throw out the Varus ultimate as well. Gets that shield from Lulu. Wild Growth not needed, so he will be able to walk out with his life, but that is going to be a recalled Elise, more than likely. So this could give Kongu a little bit more room to push up against CJ.
And then at least we'll come back with Home Guards and we'll be back to a stalemate.
Yep, and it'll just be the same thing all over again. But Dragon has spawned, so it looks like somebody's going to do something. It's going to be Monsters. They're going to go ahead and take this third Dragon
or
for
them.
So just the 5% movement speed. And now Guger taking a lot of damage. MadLife goes in, does not get the Pulverize. The flash away by Guger, and it takes a lot of damage. The ultimate is used. Crush looking for the opportunity to jump in. Piercing Arrow comes in just a little bit too early, as is that Javelin. Not going to be able to finish off the Bull. MadLife will be able to walk out with his life, but this is good return pressure by Kongdu and should give them a little bit of wiggle room to push up into this mid lane.
A smart move from CJ. They knew that Dragon was tied, so they walked towards Baron. They knew that that would force Kongdu to walk away. They would have to come contest. They're pushing up mid strongly. They know Alistar's recalling, but getting into range for auto attacks, that's a different matter.
Yeah, that is going to be the challenge here. See, looks like Bubbling on the sidelines gets caught, has to go up with the Repel. Quite low flashes the wall, the heal and the Wild Growth come through. He will stay alive. Hippo down to about 30% HP. The Black Shield does come in just in time to keep him alive, as does his great health, but it doesn't matter. Utara finishes him off with the Grand Challenge. Now over on Sol, who is just getting melted by this Fiora, who dashes away with the Valkyrie, finds the return kill. Does trade so far a 1-for-1. The top laners both going down for either side. CJ, they shove them off. They could go for a Baron here potentially, but it looks like they're going to play this safely and just back off.
Really nice moves by Sol to win that duel. It looked for sure like Fiora with Bloodthirster and Ravenous Hydra. So much lifesteal. Yep. Was able to open up that extra distance with the flash. Really nice play. I'm coming to it looking to start Baron. They've got no Tahm Kench. They still do take a lot of Baron damage.
Yeah, this is a little bit risky for them, especially since
they need to get out of there.
CJ is right there. One Pulverize on the 2 members, 3 members. Could finish it off, but it looks like they're actually going to be able to get this Baron. Corky confirms that. Jets out of there with the package. MadLife being slowed up by that Trail of Fire as well, and it looks like CJ now in a bad spot. Going to have to back off as a wave crashes into their inhibitor turret in the bottom lane. So Kongdu making a pretty solid call, able to finish the Baron before CJ arrives.
But the clever thing there from Kongdu is they actually had Corky Volk away with the package, so it actually forced the rest of CJ back. That's the stand back, kind of a bit like Draven's E. The stand aside came through. See, Dragon started, but quickly
CJ
peeled off.
Yeah, not going to be able to finish this one in time. With the arrival of four members of Kongdu Monster, it's going to be CJ running back to their base. Kongdu suddenly looking like they might be able to close out this game.
Yeah, Alistar got knocked aside, then Ezreal tried to walk over the slowing field, activated Mercurial Scimitar for the movement speed, but still was slowed because of that massive slowing field from the package. And wow, Corki actually allowed them to disengage pretty much solo.
Yeah, really solid stuff by Soul, especially after winning that 1v1 against Antara. 1v1, I put in quotes. But that's going to be the Inhibitor Tower getting knocked down. Baron-empowered minions as well, starting to chip away at the Inhibitor itself. And CJ just holding on for dear life as they try to clear out these waves. And Kongdu is just unrelenting in this push.
So few options for CJ. They need to find some sort of Wombo engage to pair with the Wild Growth, but they just really don't have the tools for it. It's why you see Elise really overextended. We see a teleport coming in, but really far away.
Yeah, really far away is an understatement. Now, the Black Shield's already been used by Cougar. He's being taken down quite low. The Shackles comes through. He gets eaten up by Hippo to try to keep him alive. Spits him out, slows back with the Tongue Lash, but Kramer's just trying to keep everybody as condensed as he can with these Mystic Shots, unable to find him. And it looks like Kongdu are going to be able to disengage relatively easily.
Crazy that they were able to siege down an Inhibitor and get away despite the really deep teleport, but that's the reality. It had to be super deep and they couldn't pair BDD and Untara together.
Oh, Madlife finds Edge. You should be consumed by Hippo. There it is. He goes into the stomach. Soul, though, the Grand Challenge comes down, has to Valk away. And now this is going to be Kramer just throwing out these Mystic Shots, but there's a good amount of return damage coming out from that Corki. Bubbling gets caught out, he gets popped, Soul finds that kill, and now CJ just running back to their base as fast as they can, but they get slowed up, Madlife goes down, a double kill for the Corki so far, Untara, the Wild Growth comes through, as does the Sterix pop, still might fall, he does, Soul finds a triple kill, and I think Kongdu Monster on this push are gonna take down CJ in game one.
Kongdu Monster playing to their win conditions consistently for 48 minutes, remember this is the 9th place team in the league, but their ability to execute the siege comp, it's on a different level to their luminary Spenu.
Yeah, what a game by Kongdu Monster, playing like we didn't think that they could. Take down CJ for game one.
Gotta say,
impressive.
I always look at these low tier comp teams and say, don't play a poke comp, it's too hard to pull off, but two series in a row against CJ Enters, they've picked up a win by playing to their win conditions, by respecting the fact they can't fight against Dragon, they can't fight in tough spots. Yep. They played consistently. They get a deserved win. And, you know, we were talking about that hyped debut of BDD. He ends the game 1-0-9. There's nothing he could do. And honestly, Kramer, BDD both didn't die. The team as a whole only had 8 kills. It was a macro game played to perfection by Kongdu Monster.
Yeah, they had 6 more kills than Kongdu did, but they still just outplayed, outrotated, and out-objectived, which is not a word. But the out-objective CJ Entis.
Out-objective.
Yep. It's a new term.
CJ needs to pick engage. This is the second time they've had minimal engage. This time they had a hope. It was all about the Wild Growth onto Untara, but they could just never execute it because, to some degree, Kongdu Monster played around and respected the little engage that was there, and the result was a pretty clean 49-minute win, you'd have to say.
Yeah. And Soul, you know, by the back end of that game, really showing up on the Corki despite being really pushed down early on, started showing up, but I mean, all respect has to go to Hippo, brought back the top lane Tom Ketch and just absolutely crushed with it.
Convincing stuff from Hippo on a champion that we thought was gone from the meta.
Yeah, this might actually be enough to draw out a ban from the Tom Ketch against him, which is
6.4, that's a crazy thing to say.
Yeah, especially when Nautilus was available and that's like his champion. So, really surprising stuff from Hippo. A very good job. But yeah, we'll see what happens when we come back for game two. Don't go anywhere. Just be a few minutes.